I'm going to give you a short introduction and fly through this, but just to refresh your memory after the coffee break. Impact and testing is a space that emerges at a time when we all realize that we can no longer afford to submerge ourselves much longer. And we know companies do good, something called corporate social responsibility, and we know companies are trying to do their best to improve the world, but we know that that is necessary, hopefully insufficient. And of course also in the light of all the government budget cuts, we can no longer depend on the corporates or the national governments to take care of some of the very pressing problems that we have. And an old axiom, profit maximization, which typically takes place when people feel the need to have ratchets, etc., in their term sheets. Profit maximization is something that at a time of growth, etc., sounds very pleasant and very nice and very good, but at a time of crisis, runs the risk for it and has demonstrated to be capable of morphing into profit maximization at any cost, and therefore eroding integrity and basic values. And that has brought a lot of investors to a space where integrity precedes profit. If you are in the energy or in the healthy drinks business, I guess you'd like to say that you are what you eat. For an investor, you are what you invest in. And if you invest in things where that don't leave a net a social profit, then that is also how you will feel. Investors then try to find investments, social investors try to find investments where purpose and profit actually go hand in hand, and where the returns on investments going from for you from left to right then also involve financial returns. And that is not easy, and we've heard this morning that that is not easy, and we're going to discuss in this panel where we've seen examples where it was also not easy, but at least possible. Now, this space has been dominated for some time, at least in terms of social impact, by philanthropy. And philanthropy has evolved into something that some philanthropists have embraced, venture philanthropy, where they said, let's not just give money away, let's also apply some business skills and some very clear expectations on how our money is being invested, but still at no return. And philanthropy, when you give money away, you can only give it away once. And it makes sense to invest it to create models in which organizations become self-sustainable entities, which then also have the possibility to pay back the initial grant or investment. And going from left to right, then we see impact investing taking place where it is very clear that it is the social impact that matters, and you see impact investment where the financial returns matter. We have a problem. Can you hear me now? Did you hear me at all?
Yes.
But there wasn't a real problem. Sorry about that. I'm not going to confuse you with too many slides, but there is a lot of work done on returns on investment, and I hope this panel will also be able to elucidate a little bit on where that social return is coming from and how it is being measured. What I would like you to realize is that the impact existing space is being financed by traditional capital, but also coming from philanthropy. Currently, it is measured at roughly a space of $50 billion, and it is expected to grow up to $500 billion in this decade. This is money that will clearly have an impact, and there are many talented entrepreneurs who are going to drive this value. What I'd like to do before we spend time talking about the investment side, I would like to emphasize, and you've heard some excellent entrepreneurs this morning, I would like to bring your attention to the pure social entrepreneurs, and they sound like this, thanks to our friends at the School for It.
I wanted to find a solution to the problem, and I wanted to do whatever it takes to end the problem.
In the mid-1970s, Bangladesh was racked with poverty and famine. Greedy moneylenders victimized local villagers who wanted to start small businesses. In one village, Muhammad Yunus counted 42 people who needed just $27 to break out of poverty.
Suddenly, an idea came to my mind. If I give this $27 to all these 42 people, they can return the money to the contributors and they will be free. And that's what exactly I did. And the happiness that it brought to me caught me. And I asked myself the question, if you can make so many people so happy with such a small amount of money, why shouldn't you do more?
Since that first bet, the bank Muhammad Yunus started has made nearly $5 billion in loans. It's a model that has been copied all over the world, spawning a movement known as microfinance.
People are demonstrably better off in the world today by virtue of that simple insight that small, unsecured loans can really make a difference. Microfinance, during the past 25 years, has demonstrated that millions and millions of people can participate in society in a normal way.
In 2006, Muhammad Yunus won the Nobel Peace Prize, testimony to the role of a new kind of change agent, a social entrepreneur.
Social entrepreneurs like Muhammad Yunus see opportunities where other people see hopeless failures. They see potential where other people see tragic consequences. They see a future that others can't even begin to imagine.
In this moment in history where government has, at least in some places, has failed to provide basic goods and services, the things that societies need to really allow individuals to thrive, social entrepreneurs are tackling those really big problems.
Problems that reach beyond microfinance, such as educational opportunity, children's health, housing, clean water, climate change.
And the problem is, if you look at what the current business organizations and governments are doing in this sort of space, it really doesn't add up to a coherent solution of the scale that we need. And therefore, I think entrepreneurs are going to be profoundly necessary. Because these are the people who sort of break up the concrete.
Most people have to see to believe.
But I think that social entrepreneurs believe and then they see. Social entrepreneurs have seen the end result before it even got started.
And they've done so all over the world. In Mozambique, Blaise Duja Santo transformed healthcare by providing reliable medical services to millions of villagers who had never previously been reached. In India, Bunker Roy's Barefoot College teaches people with no prior training to build and install solar electric technologies. And in the United States, Dorothy Stoneman has shown how young people can change their lives and their communities through job training and education.
We had 300 abandoned buildings in East Harlem where I lived. We had hundreds, maybe thousands, of young people standing on the corners with nothing to do, and lots of homeless people. So I looked at that and said, there's something wrong with this picture. Someone should hire these young people, rebuild these buildings, and create housing for the homeless people. And that's what we set out to do.
What's the most powerful force you can bring to bear? It's a really big idea, but only if it's in the hands of a really good entrepreneur. It's that combination that changes the world.
Today, thousands of social entrepreneurs are tackling a range of problems in all corners of the globe. But until recently, few of them saw themselves as part of a larger movement.
Some 20 years ago, social entrepreneurs were working alone. Fundamentally, they had no idea many times that other social entrepreneurs existed. They had an experience of essentially going against the stream, very hard. These are very tough people, but still alone.
I think social entrepreneurs have always existed, but because they haven't always been defined as social entrepreneurs, because we've not always recognized them as such, they've had no collective identity. They have been lone pioneers.
And now what you see in the world are a whole framework of supports that are coming up, coalescing very, very quickly to say, hey, social entrepreneurship is really viable.
Oxford recruits about 300 highly talented MBA students each year. Students want to know how to change the world. They want to know how the skills they learn in business school can help them change the world.
You see social entrepreneurs, and regardless of however many problems and challenges that they have, they don't give up. They just push forward and they push forward. And that's inspiring to me.
Today, Oxford is just one of many universities teaching social entrepreneurship and providing homes where practicing entrepreneurs can meet and learn from each other.
The point of supporting the social entrepreneurship movement is to create a home for those people, to make them less maverick and more of a movement.
The more we wire the field together, from local to national to global, means that ideas go from Bangladesh to the US and Brazil, Poland to South Africa. That wasn't happening 10 years ago. That's a function of the increased productivity of the field.
I think the key thing that we have to come back to time and time again is these entrepreneurs cannot do this on their own. They need support. They need support from funders, clearly, but they need strategic partnerships with mainstream business, and they need the support of government and policymakers.
What's so exciting to be alive at this moment, as a social entrepreneur connected to thousands of social entrepreneurs around the globe, is that within all of us there's this growing movement, and that there is a hopefulness in starting to look at the problems we have as our problems.
My hope for the future is that by virtue of the stories that we tell about reasons for optimism, by virtue of the small pieces of success, we build some big pieces of success, so that in a decade's time, we can say, this movement began with one very demonstrable success story, and that was called microfinance, but very quickly built a series of other success stories, and look at the effect they've had on the world.
The Thank you. I'd like to introduce a person now who has spent a lot of time helping social entrepreneurs. He is a White House veteran. He was in the capacity also a former ambassador to the He is a founding partner of Total Impact Advisors and co-author of the book More Than Money. Please welcome John Simon.
Does this work without the microphone or?
Okay,
yeah. So I will put the microphone down. Thank you, Barry. And I'd like to thank the Monaco Venture Capital Association and the International University of Monaco for organizing this wonderful conference. I have to say the panel this morning set a very high bar, so hopefully my colleagues and myself will be able to meet it. And the other thing this panel this morning did, as did the speech by History and Highness, is point out how much impact investing is in one way or another integrated